So what you are seeing over here is an engine which is there in a car, okay, which has got actually multiple cylinders. So this is how when we open the bonnet of a car, we can see the engine like this, okay. But what is there inside this engine, the piston, cylinder, and connecting rod, all that we will see today, okay. So now what we are going to see is that we'll study about the what are the parts of an IC engine and how they are, what are the terminologies that is being used. Yeah, so we have to understand what the names of the parts and the terminologies, that is there are some namings that is being used so that it indicates, okay, where is it exactly, either the, where is the piston positioned, or what is it going to do, or what is it, what does it mean. Okay, so there are certain terminologies that is being used. So basically an IC engine, it is used to convert the chemical energy into thermal energy and make use of this to do the mechanical work. Okay, this is basically by the combustion process. So when the fuel undergoes combustion, we are going to convert it into mechanical work. Okay, so one of that is by making use of an IC engine. So we can see an IC engine over here on the screen over here, an animated video, okay, which consists of so many parts. We'll see most of these parts in detail and we'll understand the names of this and what is their function. Okay. So basically when we see an engine performs like this, you can see a piston moving something that there is moving from top to bottom, and there is one rod being connected, and you can see the shaft that is going to rotate, right? So when the piston moves, we can see that this crankshaft or this shaft as of now is going to be rotated. So we'll see all of them today. Yeah. Now, so just remember this, how it functions, how this the parts are moving, because this is very much helpful. So now when we take a cut section of this, when we take a cut section of this, here what you can see is the piston cylinder. This is the cylinder of the engine. Okay, this dark portion, inverted U shape. And what we have over here is the piston. Okay, we'll see each one of these parts, okay, yeah, in detail. So what happens, basically there is fuel entering and combustion process taking place inside, okay, and we can see that thereby the piston is going to move and the shaft is going to rotate. Okay, so depending upon, yesterday we saw about whether it's a four-stroke engine or two-stroke engine and so on. Yeah, but how the strokes and all is going to work, we'll see that later on. First, let us understand. So this is a cylinder, okay? It's a cylindrical in shape, has got some height, and it is hollow inside. There is a provision for an inlet valve and an outlet valve that is to be placed. Also, there will be a provision for the spark plug or the fuel injector, right? And this hollow space is the place where the piston will be fitted, okay? And yesterday I spoke about the cooling methods for an engine, which one is the using fins, the other one is by using oil cooled or water cooled method. So what you can see like this, we can generally see like this, this protrusions on an engine in every two wheeler, these are called as the fins. Okay, this tiny thin thickness of material surrounding the cylinder, these are the fins. Okay, yes. So piston is a cylindrical in shape, okay, and here is the top portion of the piston where combustion is going to take place, and we can see three circles over here where actually piston rings will be placed over here. There will be one piston ring here, two and three. There are different purposes for this piston rings. We'll see that later on. Okay. And the next one is a connecting rod. A connecting rod is looks like this, which has got a small end bearing location and a big end bearing location. So the small end will actually go and get placed. The small end of the connecting rod will be locked over here. Inside this small cylindrical portion that is over here, it will be connected to this link to the piston, right? And the the big end of this connecting rod will be connected to the crankshaft that we'll see in the next. Yeah, yes, this is a crankshaft. This rod is the crankshaft, and what you can see, an irregular shape just like a bell, is the crank. So the big end of the bearing, the big end of the bearing will be connected to the to this place, to this circular place onto the crank, which we call as the crank. Okay, now, so what happens actually, now just look at this assembly. Connecting rod is being connected to the crank and the crankshaft. This big end of the connecting rod will be connected to the crank in that particular place. And now this connecting rod can swivel to and fro just like a pendulum. Okay, just like a pendulum. And to that small end of the connecting rod will be connected to the piston gadget pin. With a pin located, we'll push it in so that, now look at this. Now when the piston is going to move, the connecting rod has the flexibility to swivel like a pendulum. Okay, so that is the main purpose why the mechanism is like this. And then comes the piston rings, depending upon the, whether it's a two-stroke or a four-stroke engine, the number of piston rings will be decided. Okay, so generally it will be three piston rings for a four-stroke engine, where one is to avoid the mixture of air and fuel or combustion going from the top region to the bottom region, that is the crank case. The second one is for compression, and the last one is for to avoid whatever oil or anything that is present in the crankcase, that is over here in this region, not to get mixed up onto the top region of the engine. So that we are going to separate the top region of the engine and bottom region of the engine. So the purpose of the piston ring is for this. Okay, to separate what the combustion process happening on the top region and whatever the lubricant oil that is there in the bottom region or near the connecting rod and crankshaft. So, yes. So, just look here. So, this is how the entire assembly is going to be there. So, piston, connecting rod, crank, and crankshaft, all this will be assembled like this, and the piston is going to reciprocate inside the cylinder, right? So now you can see that the piston is sliding inside the cylinder, and once it is going to move or linearly move, we can see that the connecting rod is going to oscillate like a pendulum, and simultaneously what is happening, the crankshaft is also going to rotate. So what is happening over here is actually conversion of linear movement into rotary motion, right? So this is what is happening in an IC engine. We are going to convert a linear movement into rotatory motion, which is also called as slider crank mechanism. Okay, this is what you have to understand and remember this, how the mechanism works in an IC engine. Okay, and now look here carefully. The thing is that once it has been assembled, okay, and once the piston is going to move, now say for example, the piston is at the topmost position. So just look here, the connecting rod is in a straight line. So piston is at the highest position. When the piston moves down gradually, the connecting rod is going to slide to swivel, and it is going to rotate this crank. So during this time, when the piston comes from the topmost position to the bottommost position, this crank is going to rotate, or the crankshaft is going to rotate for half a rotation. From here, this crank will be positioned to the lowermost position. Just look here carefully. So the piston has moved from the topmost position to the bottommost position. So during that time, what has happened? The crank or the crankshaft has rotated by half a rotation. Previously, this portion of the crank was over here. So when the piston has moved below, the crank and the shaft has rotated by half a rotation. Okay, this is happening when? Because it is happening during when the piston is moving from the topmost portion to the bottommost portion. Please remember this. This is very important. Okay, we have to remember this because this is needed to understand in the four-stroke engine or two-stroke engine working process. And similarly, when the piston moves from the bottommost portion to the topmost position, the crank is going to rotate for another half, making it for one complete rotation. Right? So I'll replay it once again. So now the piston is going below. It has reached the bottommost position. And now now the piston cannot go furthermore below. That is the limit. Now it has to move in the upward direction. Now when it is going to move in the upward direction, the crank is going to rotate from this position and it is going to go for another half a rotation. And this is what is going to happen. Right? Okay. So for one complete rotation of the crankshaft, the piston has to move once below and once in the upward direction. That is two strokes. Two times it has to move. We call it as, once it has moved from the topmost portion to the bottommost portion, we call it as one stroke. And once it moves from the bottommost portion to the topmost portion, it is the second stroke. So two strokes will make one complete rotation of the crankshaft. So now comes the other elements, which is for these are the gears that we'll study in detail in future. And this is a valve. One is for the inlet valve and the other one is the outlet valve, which will be positioned over here. So the inlet valve is used for the inlet of the fuel or air fuel mixture or only air, depending upon what type of engine it is, whether it's a petrol engine or a diesel engine. So basically it is meant for inlet of air or air fuel mixture. And the outlet valve is always meant for the exhaust gases after the combustion process. What are the exhaust gases that is there inside the piston cylinder arrangement to be pushed out through this exhaust valve or the outlet valve. Okay, let's continue once again. So this inlet valve and exhaust valve will be fitted over here in the provision. Okay, now you can see the cut section. Okay, now you can see the cut section. Now we will see about some commonly used terminologies when this piston engine and engine and the engine is working. So the first one is the top dead center. So just now I was talking about when the piston was positioned at the highest point. Okay. So just look at it once again. The piston is at the topmost place in the cylinder. Okay, and the connecting rod is in a straight line and the crank is also at its highest position. So this is the highest point where the piston can reach in this cylinder. Okay, so it cannot go further beyond this. Okay, so that is called as the top dead center or also called as TDC in short form. Okay, this is the highest point the piston can reach inside the piston cylinder arrangement, which is also called as the top dead center. In short, we will call it as TDC, right? So next thing is, now, I was talking about when the piston has reached the bottommost position, right? So once the piston has loaded from TDC and it slides down, okay, the crankshaft goes for half a rotation, okay, and the piston reaches the bottommost position, okay? So I use the same term, bottommost position. So the actual name is technically speaking, it is bottom dead center or BDC. Okay, there's a small mistake over here. It should be BDC, bottom dead center. So this is the bottommost point where the piston can slide inside the cylinder. It cannot go further below than this. So during this time, once the piston has moved from TDC to BDC, the crankshaft has rotated by half a rotation. Yeah. Okay, so the next terminology is, we saw about the top dead center, then the bottom dead center. So the piston is going to move, say for example, from topmost center, top dead center, to bottom dead center. So it is going to travel for some length. Okay. So from TDC to BDC, it is going to travel linearly for a particular length. So that length is called as the stroke length. Okay. That length is called as the stroke length. That is the distance moved by the piston from the top dead center to the bottom dead center. What is the distance from top dead center to bottom dead center? That is called as the stroke length, or shortly called stroke also. So the next terminology that is used is clearance volume. Clearance volume. In clearance volume, what happens is that the piston is at the top dead center, it is going to be nearer to the top end of the cylinder or the cylinder head, but it is not going to completely touch the cylinder head. There is always a gap in between the cylinder head and the piston near the TDC. There is a gap. This gap is called as the clearance volume. This gap is called as the
clearance volume. Kerala.
Yeah, this gap is called as the clearance volume. Right. So the next one. So the piston is actually in cylindrical in shape. That means it has a diameter. Okay. And so that is, so thereby we can find out what is the area of this piston. Okay. And once this piston is going to move over a length from TDC to BDC, which is the stroke length denoted by L, stroke length. Okay. And this is the stroke length. And this piston has got one area. So area is already in meter square or centimeter square or millimeter square. Okay. And when you multiply it by that, by along with the stroke length, what is going to happen is that we are going to get a swept volume, because so much of volume, it is going to be moving. Okay. The piston is either going to move from TDC or to BDC or from BDC to TDC. So this volume is called as the swept volume. So the piston is going to move from TDC to BDC. It is going to capture some, okay, area or the volume, not the area. The piston has got the area, the volume. Yeah. So next thing. Generally, what happens is that inside the piston cylinder arrangement, the fuel will be atomized into very fine particles like this, and it will be sprayed. Okay. So if it is a petrol, then air fuel mixture will be coming into picture. If it is a diesel engine, only diesel will be fueled. Air will be separately filled in. That we'll talk about when we study about diesel engine. Right. Okay. So next, we shall go to, now what we have to see is that the other one is, let's look at this. Just remember this working as of now. So there is a fuel entering inside the piston cylinder arrangement.
What?
And the spark is being produced. And once the spark is being produced, the combustion takes place. Yeah. And the piston moves down because of the combustion. Yeah. And then after that, in the next stroke, the piston raises above and it is going to allow the exhaust gases to go out. But for all this, the question is that it has the inlet valve and the outlet valve has to open and close at the required timing. Okay. It has to open only during the required timing, not in irregular manner. Okay. For the time being, let us remember this. There's a particular time when this inlet valve and outlet valve has to be opened, and the other time it has to be closed. So how does this valve actually function according to the timing is required. So when we look over here onto the crankshaft, there's a gear that has been connected. From there, there is another gear to reduce its speed. Yeah. And from that gear, you can see one shaft over here. This shaft is actually connected to this gear. Yeah. So this valve is actually looking like this with a spring loaded onto it, so that whenever this lever is going to release it, this spring will pull back this valve, closing the valve. Okay, so this will just pull this valve in the upward direction once this lever is in the upward portion. So this spring will pull it backwards, and this port will be closed by this valve. Okay, so how does this actually happen? This like this. Yeah, we need to understand this. Okay, so over here we can see the gear